So welcome. So today you're going to hear from both of us, and often you'll hear a lot of overlapping. You might hear some different things. I really enjoy talking with Greg because, both personally talking to him because we often share ideas and learn from each other, but also talking in this kind of a context because we can kind of weave together different ways of approaching food and medicine. And so tonight, what tonight's going to look like is we have an hour together. We did get started a little bit late, so we'll probably go until about 7:15. Greg's going to begin with speaking for about 20 minutes, and then I'm going to speak for about 20 minutes.
So Gwenn and I work in an office up the street near the fire station. It's called Natura Medica, and it's a practice that has naturopathic physicians like Gwenn, and then I'm the acupuncturist, and we also have a medical doctor there. That's the Mystic Packer building. Just very briefly about me, she basically said my bio already anyway, so there's really, I think she said it all actually, so we'll skip that. Perfect. All right, so qualifications, I just wanted to say briefly what it takes to be an acupuncturist, just so that you have a sense, because there's a lot of confusion, I think. You drive down the road and you see a sign, acupuncture, and you never really know, is this a safe place, is this a qualified practitioner? You know, some people will even say, well, he looked Chinese, so I thought, you know, he's got to be the real thing. So these are the standards, though, in this country. Regardless whether you're German like I am or Asian, if you're going to practice in the U.S., you need to get a Master of Science degree. You need to go through in acupuncture. You need to do a one-year internship in a community clinic as part of your training. Then you have to study and pass a national board exam, obtain your state license, and then we have to maintain these by getting continuing education units, similar to nurses and physical therapists. So I often put us more on the level of an allied health professional in training. Now, a physician, though, can go off and become an acupuncturist or provide acupuncture in his practice by doing abbreviated training. We always argue that because we've been studying it for 3 years that we have a much more breadth and depth to our training than someone could possibly get in a very short amount of time, but the law is such that they give physicians a sort of a shortcut. But be that as it may, we all work together. So I just thought we would kick off this talk, even though the focus is on food, we're going to talk about digesting food in addition to food selections. So I thought we would all do a little exercise called the energy ball. If you're all up for a little experiential activity, what we're going to do is we're going to look at our palms. You're going to need empty hands for this. And we're going to take our thumb and we're going to focus on our palm and we're going to pump it 10 times. 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Pump the other palm. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. And again, one, looking at what you're doing, concentrating on what you're doing. 8, 9, 10. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Fingertips. And let's tap one more time into the palms. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Look at what you're doing right into the palm of your hand. You have to really concentrate on this. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Fingertips tapping. Close your eyes. Hold your hands 3 inches apart in front of your heart. Eyes closed. No more tapping. 3 inches apart. Palms face one another. Don't touch each other. They're 3 inches apart. Just pay attention to the space now between your hands. Anything that you might notice going on in between your hands, we're focusing on a space, that 3-inch space between our hands as our palms face one another, but they're not touching. Ever so slowly now, like it's the hardest thing for you to do, with your eyes still closed, slowly, it's almost impossible to do, dragging your hands apart. They may only go half an inch, it's so difficult. As you do so, pay attention to the space in between your hands. And now, coming back in very slowly, you may only move half an inch, it's that difficult. Just use your imagination and push with all your effort, but it's very difficult. And as you do so, pay attention to the space in between your hands and back out again. Separate those hands. Nod your head if you feel something going on inside the space between your hands. Good. Okay. One more time. Pull it out. Very difficult. Pull it back in. If you're familiar with this, go ahead and start shaping snowballs. All right, now you just clap your hands, open your eyes. Can somebody who's nodded their head share with the group what you felt? Anybody?
Feel something round.
Something round in between your hands? Energy in between? Something a little more specific for people that didn't feel anything. A heat source. Anybody else? So this pulling, did anyone get the sensation you ever put the ends of two magnets together and they bounce off? Yeah, so it's that kind of creation. The reason I bring this all up, and that's called the energy ball exercise, and it starts to feel almost like you're creating a snowball that pushes against you. And a lot of people that get this immediately are often very sensitive people, very intuitive people, artists, musicians, painters, people who are a little more logical, rational. Sometimes they're very rooted to the physical part of their being, and they don't sense too much going on right there. But it's something that you can develop and get used to. Does anybody have any questions about what it was we just did? I'm going to make the connection to food now, but if someone is still sort of like, what the heck did we just do with this guy? I want to answer the question. You know? So we're starting to talk about this idea of an energetic body versus a physical body, this idea that there's energy, and that energy is used to digest our food and our nutrients as they go through our body. Everybody with me still? Some cultures, they have this belief that the energetic body is almost separate from our physical body, yet they're constantly in a dance together, and that if, you know, for example, if we had the belief that we had chakras in an energetic system and they got congested and blocked, eventually that would start to ripple into the physical body and it would manifest with problems like high blood pressure, if our heart chakra was clogged, or back pain or disc problems. So it's this whole idea of energy influencing the physical. Who's on board with that idea? Who thinks there might be some possibility? Can I see a hand raising? Okay, just so I sort of got to figure out what kind of crowd we have tonight.
Chakra is
in a different form of medicine. We don't talk too much about chakras in Chinese medicine, at least the ways that I've studied it. But chakras are considered like energy centers in different parts of your body. Suffice it to say that they can get clogged, like a traffic jam can get clogged, and they don't function very well. And that can start to manifest in from down in the solar plexus. I could have diaphragmatic constraint, or I could get stomach problems. So it's sort of like you have energy centers. And we were working on hand chakras when we did this. Okay. So we talk about something called qi in Chinese medicine. Everyone heard of qi? This is sort of, there's a very large definition, and it's kind of broad. For the sake of right now, why don't we just think of qi and energy as sort of in the same realm of things. And we're trying to, as an acupuncturist, we're trying to unblock qi. That's one of my main jobs, is to unblock qi so that things flow naturally. So we use our qi in digesting our food. We have something we call stomach qi, which is very important for our energy, and it's involved in bringing the nutrients in, moving them through, down, and out. When our stomach qi or our energy is blocked, in Chinese medicine we talk about roadways instead of chakras, meridians they're called. When these are blocked, we can have chronic digestive problems like heartburn, nausea, constipation, irritable bowel syndrome. We can get blockages. We can get multiple blockages. They can sort of work their way up. There's even one in the throat that you can get. Some people, they can't swallow anything bulky. You ever rush to eat a meal that creates a bolus, and it just sort of gets stuck right there, and you can't seem to swallow it, and you're rushing to get out the door, but you notice that if you just slow down and relax, it moves its way down. Similar. Everybody with me so far? All right, so a couple simple terms we talk about in terms of our qi. We talk about excess and we talk about deficiency very often. So you can have the roadblock or the clogged chakra, which could be excess. and that could leave a person very irritable, have a ravenous appetite, be constipated. These are forms of excess, blockage. Qi can be very deficient, low energy person, low appetite, very loose stool, as opposed to constipation. So we often these two come together. Where there's excess, there's deficiency. If you imagine the image of a dam, I think we have a reservoir right up the street. If we have a dam, there's a lot of water up over the dam, and then there's nothing on the other side. And that often is the relationship we see with our qi. We can have an area of excess that goes correspondingly with deficiency. So we're often treating both. So it's not that your qi is so abundant that it's bad. It's more that it's blocked and it's in excess. So I think this will start to make sense as we move along. Very quick tip here. There used to be a show on PBS called Keeping Up Appearances. Anyone ever watch that show? It's this lady, Hyacinth. She always had candlelight suppers. So anyway, the idea is, though, that in Chinese medicine, they say you want to let your stomach qi go down. If you have stomach qi reversal, you're going to have nausea. You're going to have heartburns going the wrong way. And one of the ways you encourage your qi to go down is you have low light, and you don't discuss anything controversial while you're eating, and you don't keep company with people who are going to upset you or who don't appreciate you or who are going to antagonize you, because that's going to cause qi constraint and qi reversal. And that can perpetuate your chronic condition. So that may sound very ideal, but even something as simple as not answering emails while you wolf a sandwich down and getting upset what you're reading, I've got so much to do, why is this person asking me again? You know, these kinds of things that cause qi constraint. Other ways that we can help our stomach qi to do its job is taking time to cook. I know convenience is great. Often the people that come to these talks already take the time to shop and cook, so I'm probably just telling you things that you folks already know. But while it's very easy to go to Big Y and buy a rotisserie chicken, wouldn't it be great to take the time to buy your vegetables, chop them up, let the broth and the onions start to simmer on the stove. You stimulate your senses. The stomach qi is preparing to do its job, so you're not just forcing going from A to B, or A to Z. You're trying to just sort of warm things up and get them to go down easily. So taking time to really prepare foods is really an important piece, especially if you have a lot of issues with qi reversal. So far, so good? Still kind of common sense. Other things that we just mentioned, people skipping meals, not eating breakfast, and then as the day goes on, eating a very huge meal at night before bed. That's going to not give you a consistent sense of energy. Not having a good ratio of proteins, carbohydrates, and fats in every meal. We like to have all of these. You know, low fat is a whole other issue, but we're just going to say we want proteins, carbs, and fats for now. Lots of vegetables. Another one that is common is for people to graze throughout the day. Sometimes they do it because they don't want to overeat later, so they'll actually nibble, and they'll even nibble things like nuts and raw vegetables and things throughout the day. But the notion is that your stomach qi needs to do its work, and then it needs to rest. So if you're constantly grazing throughout the day, you're depleting your stomach qi, and you sort of are putting yourself into a deficient state where you won't have a good appetite coming for that next meal because you've been sort of snacking all day long. Still kind of common sense. All right, so now let's think about the temperature outside. Hot days in summertime, cold days in winter. We're leaving hot, we're going into cold. So as we do this, we want to start thinking about how we're going to eat during these seasons, during the change in seasons to support our bodies. People are starting to wear sweaters now. Fewer people in the room are wearing short sleeves. So now's the time to start thinking about changing your foods from cold to hot. Right, yep. So in the summertime, we've been eating lots of cool vegetables, watermelon, cucumbers, cold drinks even, as a natural desire to cool our insides. As we're moving now into the cold, we want to shift. Some people will still have salads with Caesar salad with chicken on it. It's a healthy choice. It sounds very healthy, and even having raw vegetables. We watched a movie here, the
last week or this week, was it? Last week. That talked about eating raw vegetables all the time. So I'm just here to share the message of Chinese medicine, in that in the wintertime, we like people to have warm cooked foods because it's easier on our digestive systems, especially the stomach and then also the organ, the spleen, which I won't get into. But we're looking for warmer foods, and that means hopefully taking the time to make nice stews and soups. They're very nourishing and they're warm. You know, you go into a restaurant, they put an icy glass of water down on the table automatically in front of you. So the idea would then also be at least to try to strive for room temperature, or you could ask for a cup of tea. So these are important as we start to look at the development of chronic conditions. We want to be able to start to make sure that we're eating in a way that supports our stomach qi, but all of our organs. You know, the person that is chronically shivering and cold, even in the summertime, is that person on a raw diet? Is that person vegan? Is that person not having, you know, eating a lot of like cereals and grains and not really having nourishing hot foods? These are important to give us energy. And I will say Chinese medicine loves meat as well. So meat, especially in the winter, has a lot of vitamins in it, and it also is a great heat generator. So for my meat lovers in here. All right, so cold. Let me just make sure I covered everything. All right, so now we've talked about the seasons and trying to eat with the hot and the cold, and we even know that if we go grocery shopping, there's a recommendation often to try to buy the foods that are in season, not to in February to buy the strawberries, but to try to buy the foods locally that are in season. So now you can have external temperatures, but now you have the internal temperatures. I started talking about people who are wearing a lot of jackets in the room, short sleeves here, short sleeves there. So everyone's got a different experience of temperature going on, and that's always going to be an issue between us. So some people might have cold that has invaded their interior. They could have this very chronically lifelong, but they could have cold that has invaded us. And that's a way that Chinese medicine often expresses that accumulation of exterior into interior. They call it an invasion. So a person who might have a very pale complexion, a very soft voice, low energy, this person's very slow to move. You know, it's not the person that's running around and hyper. This person may be, but not necessarily, may love to be a vegan year-round, cold, raw foods. But the remedy for this person is really to reduce raw foods and cold drinks and bring in the warm cooked foods and teas. So, and then warming herbs like garlic and cloves. Questions at all? Any of that? So then there's the hot person. The person, imagine a man who's got a red face, coming at you very irritable, moving quickly, very quick-tempered. This person could also have hypertension. This person may like spicy meats, may like to drink, and may like to smoke. This person has generated, most likely, a lot of internal heat. And that person needs to start to switch to the cooling foods. Am I doing on time? Okay. So that would mean cooling vegetable drinks, which this type really might be a tough sell for that person. I think I've found that the deficient type is more likely to embrace warm soups and stews, but the more the excess heat type is going to be less likely to want to switch to, you know, V8 drinks and so forth. So that's just my experience, but anyone can change at any time when they have the desire, of course. So people become out of balance, basically, is the message. And we want to choose foods that don't exacerbate the imbalance that we already have. We want to use food to sort of counteract an imbalance and to support our health and our well-being. So the people who have a lot of interior heat are going to be really uncomfortable in the summer. We all have seen people who, two people on the same day, one person is really miserable, the other person might even find it refreshing and kind of enjoyable. So this is kind of Chinese medicine's explanation for it. Same thing with the person that's cold all the time. Winter is just so unbearable for these people. We all have met them at one time or another. So we talked about hot and cold, and then there's another condition I'll just touch on called dampness that Chinese medicine distinguishes. So let's think about a real damp, humid day. We get sluggish, we don't want to eat, we're kind of unable to move quickly. Or I took a class in a basement schoolroom once, and I remember it smelled moldy in there, and I remember feeling like I was getting a runny nose or allergies or congestion. So we're always interested in dampness, if dampness is invading us the way hot and cold can invade us. So some of the ways that we look to see if dampness has invaded a person is often a lot of gas and bloating is one sign of it. If you eat a meal and you just feel like your intestines are just very bloated, that can be one sign of dampness. And dampness can be perpetuated if you have too much greasy food. Dairy is often a piece that acupuncturists will tell people to cut out of their diet, especially if they see that they have a lot of phlegm or dampness in their system, and cutting out milk and cheese. Also, too much sweets and sugar, and even things like nuts and orange juice can perpetuate dampness. So I know those sound like very good choices. This is why it's so important to, I guess, not just listen to broad range recommendations about what's good for us, but to actually choose the things that are specific to our inner condition. Because we could be eating a lot of nuts and be very damp. So. And then chicken soup, of course, is another good one. They recommend a lot of chicken soup in Chinese medicine, but that's good for dampness. So these are just a few examples of ways that we sometimes talk about people if we're doing a traditional Chinese medicine approach. One is called stomach fire, a lot of heat in the stomach organ. This person has like a bottomless pit, ravenous appetite. This person will say, I just can't eat enough. There's something called lung fire. This person has a barking cough. You know it when you hear it. It's really loud. There's liver fire. This person has a lot of, often there's a meridian that sort of flows up and around like this. And this person could get temple headaches. They could get pain going down the leg and just be just very pent up. Then there, in terms of deficiency, there's the one called spleen, stomach qi type of deficiency. That's more along the lines of the cold type individual. The stool is kind of not necessarily diarrhea, though it could be. It could just be very loose, broken apart, undigested food visible in the toilet. Low appetite, don't even have much of an appetite. Something called stomach cold, a lot of cold in the stomach, sort of the opposite of stomach fire. Eating a lot of ice cream, a lot of icy drinks, and it can just hurt to add cold to cold. And then there's large intestine cold, which is like a diarrhea. So I thought I would just show a quick needle just to give people a sample of what they look like. This is they're sterile needles. They come in packages, and they're thin. Everyone thinks that a needle is like a hypodermic needle because that's, if you haven't had acupuncture, that's your association. Hypodermic needles go into a vein. We go into skin, into muscle, and we don't inject anything into the body. These are solid. These aren't hollow. So it comes in a sterile package. It has a handle. It has a plastic guide tube, which helps us to do a straight shot into the patient. And there's a shaft of a needle in there, which you can barely see, but just understand that there's a very thin line in this tube, and that's the part of the needle that we don't touch. We touch the shaft, we touch the handle, we don't touch the shaft. So it unsnaps like that.
Hmm? Oh, it's just gonna happen my arm.
Oh. Okay. So can you see that?
Does that hurt when you do that?
It doesn't. There's a little pinch, but you know the funny thing about the pinch, I think that as an acupuncturist, we don't want to hurt people, we want to help people, but if we don't press the needle in firmly to start, it actually will have more of a pinch than if we use a little more force. So it's kind of doing the opposite of what you think. Would you agree? We have. So, you've seen it, you've seen it. You folks? Okay, all right. All right, you guys gotta look. So basically what we do is we use the needles to unblock the qi. When someone has heartburn or some of these issues, we can use points on the meridians as a way of unblocking these roadways. The idea that we have meridians that have essentially like traffic jams and we can unjam these. And then it's medical waste. We throw them out. We take insurance in the office. I just wanted to mention that more plans are starting to get involved, but not a lot, to be honest. So I thought now we would have Gwenn come up.
All right. So So I'm going to talk specifically today about three different foods, but I really, the two things that I really want you to know kind of going into this talk are, the two take-home messages, I should say, are that I could have chosen any three vegetables to be on this list, literally any three vegetables. And what's important to me to say that to you about is that really we get our best food, our best medicine from these plant foods, from the foods that have a lot of nutrients in them, that really our bodies have been, you know, for generations we've been digesting and absorbing, and there's a lot to be said for that. The other thing, the other kind of take-home message, which I'll come back around to, is that we all wish there was a magic diet that worked for everyone. We all are looking for it. We're all trying different things. And I want to say that that just unfortunately does not exist, but then fortunately it doesn't exist as well. So I watch a lot of people come in after trying different diets and things, and you know, every diet will work for a certain percentage of people. Every diet will work for a certain period of time. But I do think that as we search for this optimal diet, what always comes back to is vegetables, and then I would add to that exercise, which is not actually diet, but it's kind of a general diet, kind of our diet of what we bring into our lives on a daily basis. So I'm just going to start with this quote, because I'm sure a lot of people have heard it before, but it's my favorite quote. It's really the only thing, with all the nutrition science that we have behind us, with all of the information that we had to have it in front of us, this is what we know about nutrition. Eat is by Michael Pollan, who wrote In Defense of Food and also Omnivore's Dilemma, and appears in a lot of different documentaries. He says, eat food, not too much, mostly plants, period. So I just want to say too, you know, when we talk about vegetables here, we kind of, you know, I think about how much more kind of air time we get around things that are processed, saying, oh, this is the really healthy type of X food, or this is a really good yogurt, or this is this. And there's no commercials, or there's nothing out there saying, hey, celery, you know, this is great stuff. It's actually really good for lowering blood pressure, but that's kind of side point. So really when we get to these foods, these are the sort of unsung heroes of the grocery store. There's a story that I like to tell about that a lot of herbalists pass around, which is that there's a herbal professor who sends his students out into the field and says, okay, for our final exam, you need to find me a plant that's not medicinal. And the story goes that if anyone brought back a plant, that they failed the exam. And basically where that's coming from is really saying that all plants have medicine for us. Some of them are toxic, and we have to use that medicine a little bit differently, but really looking at the fact that all plants are medicinal for us. And within that, too, and kind of within that sort of search for the optimal diet and that search for the one-size-fits-all sort of meal plan, is that I really like talking with Greg, because really he sort of, from a Chinese medicine perspective, but also presents a certain concept of not the same foods are as good for everyone. So we come out with, you know, in Western medicine right now, there's a lot of new studies, like, oh, this compound is really good for this, or this is good for this. And a lot of times we can end up in a very much of an informational or intellectual space about thinking about our food. But I think that one of the most important questions when we look at diet and diet changes and what are healthy diets for people is how they really feel on those foods. So, you know, especially because looking at this from a Chinese medicine perspective, you could have two people sitting next to each other, and I'm sure you all have experienced this in your household, that one person eats a food and they say, oh, this is wonderful, I feel so good, and the other person says, wow, I have the worst heartburn ever, I'm ready to like go lie down now, or actually not lie down, but I just feel awful. So, you know, you really can see this happen in your lives and on a day-to-day basis. And so that's why when we kind of are searching for these answers when it comes to diet and food, really they're personal answers. We collect information, but really those answers about diet and food are really always very personal. In terms of what foods work for our specific constitution and our specific health conditions. So today I did choose three foods to talk about. These are some of my favorites. Pumpkin is especially a favorite because it's the season of pumpkins, and pumpkins are chock full of lots of good nutrients. A lot of times we like to decorate them and have them outside, but we can also enjoy them dietarily as well. So especially the seeds. If you want to have a beautiful pumpkin outside, keeping the seeds, you're getting a lot of good nutrients from them, and they're delicious. There's actually a lot of fun recipes of putting different spices on top of them, like cinnamon on top, or doing all kinds of things with your pumpkin seeds, so you get all the good nutrients from that. Quite delicious. So looking at pumpkin, we have some pictures here. I like the visual association, so I don't know. My visual association might not make any sense to you. That one right there is the immune system. Oh, I guess I wrote immune system because I don't know if anybody else would have noticed that. But then we have skin here, eyes, and this right here is the serotonin molecule. So that has a little happy, because serotonin is the molecule that is affected by all the Prozac and all of the serotonin reuptake inhibitors that, and also the one that tends to make us feel happy, makes us feel sleep well, and also tends to make us not crave carbohydrates quite so much. So vitamin A is really important for many different functions. I kind of pulled out a couple of them that are probably the easiest to just sort of state in small sentences. So I could list you a lot more benefits of vitamin A, but these are the top ones that we think about. Vitamin A is also known as retinol. So basically, you can hear the word retina in there, and it's mostly related to that back of your eye. There are some good studies about vitamin A and improving night vision. So really, we think about vitamin A in the eyes quite a bit. It's also really good for skin health. So it's really good for all of those cells that are more of what we call epithelial cells, the top layer of cells. It helps those cells be healthy. There was a study about reducing wrinkles, about vitamin A reducing wrinkles. Fiber, we'll kind of come back around to that when we talk about flax seeds. Fiber, we can't say enough about fiber. Fiber does a lot of great things. And what I really think about fiber, the essence of what it does for us is help our natural detoxification processes function optimally. So we think about a lot of different detox programs, and there's a lot of things out there, and a lot of people feel great after they do these detox programs. We actually have detox systems in our body all day, every day. So we have urine production, we have stool production, and we have sweating. So these are all different ways that our body sort of gets rid of extra things that it and the liver mostly makes, kind of chooses between what stays and what goes and helps to get the things that need to go out of our bodies. But once the liver gets those things out of our bodies, we need the stool to carry it all the way out. And as long as we're not having daily bowel movements, that system gets a little bit backed up. So we end up not being able to effectively move the things out of our bodies that we would like to not have inside our bodies. So what fiber does is it really helps to pull things out of the body and to create stool and then move those things out of the body that our liver has decided are not good for our body. This includes cholesterol. So I will refrain from the last time I told the whole cholesterol story and I watched people's eyes glaze over. So I'm just going to say this time I won't do that to you all, I promise. I only realized it after I was like 3 minutes in. So, but basically, know that your liver also produces cholesterol. So we take in cholesterol and our liver produces cholesterol. If we don't have enough fiber or we don't have enough sort of movement of things out of our body, that cholesterol by the liver just gets absorbed again. So we actually, this is a contributor to, one of many contributors to high cholesterol. So fiber is often a really important part of treating high cholesterol. And then we have zinc. Zinc is especially important in this area. I used to work in Oregon, and I saw far less zinc deficiency there. And I realized the other day, it was 2 years ago, why that was is because there's a lot of copper pipes here. So copper and zinc competitively compete for absorption. And so a lot of people in this area specifically who have copper pipes are a little bit zinc deficient. So what that looks like, a lot of times you'll see, they get kind of very cold that comes around. Their white blood cell count can be a little bit low. Their ALK-phos, which is one of their markers on their labs, can be a little bit low. And all those things improve when they start taking zinc. Often a lot of people who are low on zinc will notice that their sense of smell is decreased. So that's another indicator that I look for in terms of looking for zinc deficiency. But it's really high in pumpkin seeds. Pumpkin seeds are actually one of the foods that are considered the most high in zinc of any food. Tryptophan is that precursor, one of the precursors to serotonin. It's two steps ahead of serotonin. So basically, when we eat things that are high in tryptophan, it makes it easier for our body to make serotonin. And then potassium. Potassium becomes really important, especially for times that we're sweating, which generally this time of year we're not doing a lot of sweating for the most part, but it's still a nice supportive nutrient there. And now we have flax seeds. Another one of my favorites. I think of all the foods, this is my most prescribed food. In terms of, I use it to treat a lot of different conditions. I use it a lot in menopause, and I use it a lot in high cholesterol, and even more so in both. So generally, and this is one, it's so high in omega-3 fatty acids that I do need to say that if anyone's on a blood thinner, I would not recommend this as a therapeutic food, especially in these therapeutic doses of the 2 tablespoons per day. So flax seeds are these little, I'm not sure if everyone has seen them, they're very tiny, but they're chock full of all kinds of good things. The top things that they have that we know of that are good for health are omega-3 fatty acids and lignans. So omega-3 fatty acids are a type of you probably have heard a lot about them. People talk about it in terms of fish oil. So they're a type of fat that is that we know is correlated with lower levels of inflammation. So omega-6s and 9s, which often are found in things like red meats, and especially red meats coming from animals that have been fed corn, we notice there's a difference there, tend to create more inflammation, where these omega-3 fatty acids tend to decrease inflammation. So in order to get to all the good stuff in the flax seeds, we do need to grind them. And there's a little trick associated with that, is that oil, once you grind it and that oil is exposed to oxygen, it does, it gets very, it's very sensitive to the oxygen, so it'll go rancid quite easily. I don't recommend that people buy flax oil for this reason, is because it's very, it's probably already rancid by the time you're getting it, so you're not getting the full benefit of the fats. So the best way to do flax seeds is, well, there's two best ways. There's one easier and one a little bit more challenging. The easiest way to do good flax seeds, to get all the benefits from flax seeds, is to get a vacuum-packed bag or just a regular bag, and as soon as you open it, keep it in the refrigerator, so you get the preservation of those oils. And the other way to do it is actually to get whole flax seeds and grind them up in your coffee grinder until they're kind of a fine, not a powder, but until they're powdery, I guess I should say, and you can put those directly into your freezer or your refrigerator after you do that. So those are the best ways to get the most out of your flax seeds. In terms of lignans, there's small amount of research. I wouldn't really hang my hat on it, saying that it's liver protective. It makes sense to me, but we don't have the direct research that we'd like to say to be able to really make this claim. This is kind of a claim in parentheses. This is the number one food in lignans, so not number one food for protecting the liver. It's really has the highest levels of lignans. Lignans are most helpful for reducing hot flashes. And part of the way they do this is like other phytoestrogens, where they go to the estrogen receptor and they kind of gently stimulate it. So they basically, when we have estrogen receptors and we have estrogen, and all of us do, even men have estrogen, and so basically the estrogen usually binds to that receptor and then it causes all kinds of things to happen after that. When we start to have decreased levels of estrogen, suddenly these pathways are not happening as much, and that little window of where we feel comfortable temperature-wise decreases. So what these lignans do and other phytoestrogens is they go to that receptor and they kind of gently stimulate some of those pathways. And what's good about this is that it decreases the symptoms of low estrogen, kind of like smooths out that transition to having lower levels. Because often we're noticing pretty dramatic ups and downs during perimenopause and menopause. It smooths that transition, but it also doesn't have the kind of side effects that are associated with taking hormone replacement therapy, which is totally appropriate for some people and not for others. So we're seeing, because of that gentle stimulation as opposed to the more direct stimulation, we're not seeing the side effects. In some studies, we're even looking at phytoestrogens being protective against hormone-related cancers, like breast cancer, specifically. So antioxidants, just to kind of go over what that means. We hear a lot about antioxidants, and basically what antioxidants mean is that we have a lot of free radicals, so they're things that are oxidized in our body, and things get oxidized for all kinds of reasons. The flaxseed that's left out in the oxygen gets oxidized. So that means that it has a little bit of a different charge on it, and it also, when it travels around your body, it's kind of prone to creating havoc. So it'll be in your blood vessels, and it'll contribute to the creation of some of the plaques that people develop in their blood vessels. It'll go and it'll contribute to some cellular changes that then can cause some cellular growth that we call cancer. And it can, basically these are the little problematic things that are going around in our body causing all these troubles. And what antioxidants do is basically find those and neutralize them and make them not free radicals anymore. So they basically just balance out the those little things that we all have going through our body at any given time. And our body has lots of great systems for really taking care of those free radicals as well. But eating these antioxidants, eating these vegetables really supports those pathways that do that naturally. And then we have garlic. I did save this one to the end. This one is the one, I mean, actually all of them you could probably, but especially garlic, I could probably, I won't get out of the slide. I could literally talk for hours about garlic. There's a lot to say about garlic. And you know, what gets strange about foods and herbs, and people are often thrown off by it because we're used to a medical model where we have a single medication that's for one thing. So we have on here, you can see the list here, and I don't know how athlete's foot made it to the top of this list, but hey, you know, like, if you've ever had it, it's very annoying, so it is, you know, very important. But we have things all the way from heart health to antibacterial. So, you know, how is it that this one herb does both of those things that are so separate? And basically, the part of the reason that this happens in herbal medicine is because herbs contain many active constituents, and often those active constituents are working together to do any of these activities here. So it may seem strange that all of these are on the same list, but actually it's because for garlic specifically, this one compound, allicin, is doing quite a bunch of different things as well. So this may reduce tick bites. I thought it'd be like, there's a small study that if you eat a lot of garlic, you might be less likely to get a tick bite. I don't know. It's worth, you know, if you're taking garlic, it's good for you for all these other reasons, so why not? Maybe it's an extra benefit. The big thing that I actually think about with garlic specifically, especially as we're kind of rolling into, you know, our cold flu season, is that it's a really powerful antimicrobial. It's a very powerful antibiotic. And I was at a talk by a man from NIH who was talking about how, you know, we're really reaching a certain level of crisis around the fact that there are no new antibiotics coming down the pike. We don't have any that are in development. We've got a lot of new superbugs coming up. There's a big question right now in the medical community, what are we going to do about all this? He was proposing an addition of garlic to all the antibiotics, so that basically in the pill there would be the antibiotic and garlic. I'm not sure, you know, that probably will take another 10 years to actually happen, but we might see it. So basically, the one thing that is really important about this is that we see garlic being effective in infections such as MRSA, multi-drug resistant staph aureus, that's MRSA. You might know it more as that. So we see it being effective in a lot of really hard to treat infections as well. So I don't generally recommend, especially when people have serious infections, I would never recommend doing garlic instead of an antibiotic, but often doing garlic along with an antibiotic can help the antibiotic to be more powerful. And to develop less of the resistance to that antibiotic. So I will stop myself from talking on and on about garlic. Yes, would you like to ask a question?
Yeah, how do you feel about probiotics?
Probiotics, I love them. And there's lots of good research about them. So there's a lot of good research. Actually, let's go ahead and kind of transition into the question and answer. So Greg, if you want to come up. And we can go into that. But yeah, in terms of probiotics, there is a big range of quality, and this comes up in all supplements. So basically, we have some supplements that are basically holding the standards of FDA regulation. They're cGMP certified, it's called. Basically means that they're testing their supplements to make sure that there are no contaminants, that it actually contains what it says it contains, and that there's nothing that could be potentially harmful or that it doesn't contain what it doesn't say it contains. And this is really important because actually as we do studies about supplements, we find that sometimes they do contain things that they don't say they contain. And I've heard some really kind of nerve-wracking things about that. I only use medical-grade supplements because I don't really feel comfortable using the other ones. And this becomes even more important with probiotics because a lot of them, you know, by the time they're testing them, actually, by the time they're on the shelf, either don't contain active probiotics anymore, or there's been some that have been found to have potentially harmful bacteria in them. So I always tell people that you want medical grade ones, or you want to get the ones that are in the health food store in the refrigerated section. Those are your best bet. They're going to be expensive, but if you spend less on the other ones, they probably won't necessarily be worth it. So there's exceptions to that for sure.
Mm-hmm. And then I have a question about
Yeah. I think, this is actually a good question kind of in a general sense, because so when we think about vegetables in general, a lot of times we think about them as, in this country, we think about them often as condiments. And really, I say 4 to 6 cups of vegetables a day, at least, so basically vegetables becoming like a very much like the majority of the food that's on your plate. So within that context, maybe tonight it's, pumpkin soups, you're actually eating 2 cups of pumpkin or 1.5 cups of pumpkin. And another night it might be broccoli, so you might be eating a whole bunch of broccoli. And it's nice to get the varied, if we ate the same vegetable every day, it wouldn't serve us so well. So
a big one is, she's asking what conditions people often come in with. I think heartburn, something called a plum pit chi, we call it, which is that sensation that there's something that you can't swallow away, but there's nothing actually there. There's also this sort of obstruction of food that I was talking about earlier, very difficult to swallow bulky things or things that are mucusy producing like rice or things like that that get gooey. Then digestion is a big one. I see a lot of people that have irritable bowel syndrome. They sort of bounce between loose stool, gas, bloating, to constipation. And that's another one that is sometimes people just come in with constipation. So what we're trying to do is acupuncturists, we're trying to remove the blocks. And acupuncture can be very helpful for that. Often in combination though with lifestyle changes, with things that Gwenn is talking about in terms of food choices. For example, with constipation, a big thing I like to say is more exercise, less sitting. So there's always that point where acupuncture can only do so much if the person isn't really taking a look at the other pieces themselves.
So again, this is very much, it's different for everyone. I think people eating at lunch is the biggest meal is often the most conducive to good digestion is what I see. I don't know if Chinese medicine might have a different perspective on that. It also depends if you're in the middle of a busy work day and you're scarfing down your lunch, that's probably not the best time to eat the biggest lunch. In terms of the never letting the stomach chi rest and that causing some problems, I do see some people feeling a little bit more bloated when they're doing the small snacks. Sometimes what I say is do the 3 big meals and ideally they're all warm. Well, depending on again who the person is and what kind of symptoms they're having, and then possibly 2 other snacks there. Because the other thing, coming from more of the naturopathic medicine perspective is that we want to prevent over hunger so that you don't come to your next meal, ravenous and sort of overeat at your next meal. So ideally your meals are exactly the same time every day. So you really train your body to prepare, to sort of like start to digest before you even introduce the food. Like Greg was talking about preparation as well. Mm-hmm. Yep. But really keeping the timing the same is probably even more important than, great. It looks like we're up for time, but thank you all so much for coming.
Thank you.